Come on, stand to your feet. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise this morning. Who's ready to praise the Lord with us this morning? Say yes. I said, who's ready to praise the Lord with us this morning? Say yes. Hallelujah. Come on, let's get ready to praise the Lord this morning.
Let me go.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I praise Him.
Jesus, we bring you honor this morning, God. And God, we declare that your name is holy. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest. Lord, you are holy. Holy are you, Lord. All creation cries out that you are holy, God. Psalm 99:9 says, exalt the Lord our God. Come worship him at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy. He is holy, he is set apart, he is worthy to be praised. Beloved, you came this morning to worship at his holy mountain. And as you exalt him, as you worship him, as you cry, holy are you, Lord, all of heaven and all of earth pays attention. And we align our hearts with heaven this morning because he is holy and he is worthy to be praised. Will you say that with me? Holy is the Lord God Almighty. Worthy are you to be praised. Father, we worship you this morning. We praise your name, O God, because you are holy. There is none like you, Father, Jesus, Holy Spirit. So as we cry out to you, Lord, this morning, as we exalt you, I pray that you would align us with everything that heaven has here on earth. Be holy in our lives, Lord. Seal this in our hearts. In your amazing name I pray, Jesus. Amen. Can you give a shout out to the Lord this morning? Thank you, worship team. Well, good morning, everyone. You can have a seat. I have a few announcements for you. How are you doing this morning? That's it? How are you doing this morning? All right. It is good to be in the house of the Lord with all of you. If we have not met, my name is Melanie, and I'm one of the pastors here on staff, and it's such a pleasure and an honor to be here this morning worshiping with you. I have some announcements for you. I have quite a few, so I'm going to ask that you not tune out because there is something for absolutely everyone this morning. All right, so this evening, we have our prayer and intercession equipping workshop. I want to invite you to come out. There's still space. It's from 5 to 7 p.m. You will not want to miss the teaching and equipping and impartation and activation and all of that fun stuff that Pastor Dave and Reverend Shelby will be leading us through this evening. So you can still sign up in the lobby, but come on out 5 to 7 this evening. Coming up this Saturday, we have a free Easter egg hunt community event. Shout, yeah, that's exciting. It's free, it's going to be fun. We are doing this in partnership with California Highway Patrol, our neighbors across the street. We're going to block off this street. There's going to be an egg hunt for various ages. There'll be bounce houses, games, vendors. There'll be crafts in the lobby. There will be a live petting zoo. Right? And it's free, a live petting zoo. And I promise you, it will not be bad. It will be really great. Ba-dum-bum. Okay, so you're not going to forget that, right? But we need volunteers. You guys, this is such an exciting opportunity to welcome our community to say, hey, we're really fun people to hang out with, and we want you to know that you are welcome here anytime. So please, if you can give us a couple of hours, it's from 2 to 5. We need volunteers to be friendly faces and help out with all the exciting stuff we have going on. And if you still want to bring candy, we need some more candy for our Easter egg hunt. That's this Saturday, the 23rd, 2 to 5 p.m. Then after that, March 29th is Good Friday. And we are hosting a walk through the Stations of the Cross from 6 to 8 p.m. This is an amazing time to come and reflect the incredible sacrifice that Jesus gave for us. It's kind of a come and go. You can come anytime during that time from 6 to 8 and walk through the stations and experience somewhat of what Jesus did on our behalf. It's very reflective and contemplative, but it is incredibly powerful. I want to ask you to invite a friend. Please invite a friend. Some of the testimonies from our past Stations of the Cross have been so incredibly powerful. But don't miss this opportunity to invite a friend to come and see what that's all about. So mark your calendars for Good Friday the 29th. And then guess what's after Good Friday? Easter! He has risen! He has risen. There you go. Okay, so Easter Sunday, we will be having two services, one at 8:30 and one at 10 a.m. I want you to look around this room, and I want you to look for an empty chair. Everybody look right now. Okay, see that empty chair? Now think about, who would you love to see in that chair Easter Sunday? Who is that important to you that you want to make sure that they hear the good news of Jesus? We've made it super easy for you. Look again at those empty seats or the seat next to you. There are cards on the seats. Pick it up and wave it at me. That is an invitation card. It is so easy to use. You can put it on your neighbor's door. I don't know, maybe their car windshield. But I encourage you to hand it to them in person and invite them to come out on Easter Sunday. You guys, this is a Sunday that is... people invited on Easter Sunday are more likely to come than any other Sunday. Don't miss that opportunity to allow them the opportunity to hear the gospel of the good news. Amen? Okay, I don't want to see one card left on the seats. Take them all and use them. Don't leave them in your car or in your pocket, okay? All right, one last announcement. On Easter Sunday, we're going to be doing baptisms. That's something to shout about, right? If this is something, your next step in your faith journey, I want to encourage you to sign up. You can get baptized at the 8:30 service or the 10 a.m. service. If you know someone that might want to get baptized on Easter Sunday, really cool, right? Invite them. You can sign up in the lobby or online or come talk to one of us. But again, don't miss that opportunity. Amen? All right. Okay, well, we are at the point in our service where we get to give our tithes and our offerings. So if you're able to stand right now, would you please stand to your feet? We're going to pray this blessing together. And then afterwards, there are baskets in the front and in the back. You can put your tithes and offerings in there. And then I want you to go and find someone afterwards that you haven't met yet and tell them that they are extra special today. All right? I'll give up the jokes. Okay. All right. If you'll point your eyes to the screen on the count of three, let's say this together. One, two, three. Amen.
Turn down screen brightness. So, God willing, this will abate. We'll just see what God does. I'm
all righty, everyone. Good morning, good morning, good morning. As we find our way back to our seats. Hey, thanks everybody for being here this morning. My name is Cam, and I'm one of the pastors here if we have not met yet. And we just want to welcome you as we continue forward in worship this morning. Isn't God so good? He is so good, and it's such an honor and joy and privilege to worship together. If you're a guest, we want to welcome you to our church community and thank you for being a part of our family this Sunday. And if you want to stop at our connection desk, we would love to get to know you more. We have a gift for you. And hey, for those of you tuning in online, it's not happening today other than audio, but maybe you'll hear this, and we love you still. But I want to give a special shout out in the room this morning. One of our congregation members is here for the first time in a long time. John Shepherd is in the house. Yes, we are so happy, John, you are here. And can I just tell you, this morning I shook John's hand, and as he does with everybody, as you know, if you know John, he looked me right in the eyes and he says, "Pastor, it's a miracle I'm here today." And can I just say, it is a miracle, and we celebrate the miracle that you are and the miracle that each one of us is in this room, that we get to gather and worship the Lord today. Amen? Amen, amen. So we're glad you're here, John. And hey, we also have another amazing guest that is with us this morning. As a part of Cucamonga Christian Fellowship, we are part of what's called the Free Methodist Church. And in our denomination, we have conferences that are set up. And right above us is the state of Oregon. And there is a conference for the Oregon Conference of Churches up there. And the superintendent from that conference is with us this morning to bring forth the word. And so as Robroy makes his way to the stage, why don't we give him a warm welcome and warm round of applause? So this is Robroy Ranger, and he is going to be guest speaking for us today. And as you'll hear, he is a man of God. He's a man after God's heart. And I know he's got a powerful word for us this morning as we continue in our series called Breakthrough and Pursue God for Unity in Our Nation and in Our World. Amen? Amen. We're so glad you're here, brother. God bless you.
Thank you so much. Well, it's good to be here. Can I ask the house lights be the ones in my eyes? I've got a migraine coming on, believe it or not. I have not had a migraine before service ever. And so God is up to something. Amen? So we're going to trust in that. So as you said, my name is Robroy Ranger, and I am the superintendent for the Free Methodist Church in Oregon. And in a delightful twist of tradition, we discovered that superintendents are actually called the Right Reverends. And so you could call me the Right Reverend Robroy Ranger if you like. You can kiss my ring later and all that kind of good stuff, you know. I actually have a family, and this is my family, and there we have them, and my son-in-law, my daughter, Ashley, my wife, Jacqueline, and myself, my youngest daughter, Angel, she's 18, and my son, Selby. Selby's a missionary in Kyrgyzstan, and so he's with us right now, but he's on his way back, so we're excited to have him in our home for a bit. We as Australians, if you haven't figured it out already, have a specific way of looking at the world, which I would say is correct. And in Australia, we sort of have a code. We don't really talk about it too much, but you know, I have a word for Janelle. We speak a different language. I don't know if you know that, but Janelle, I just want to let you know, Wagga Wagga, Taramara, Woolloomooloo, Billabong, Warunga, yeah. Right? Yeah, all right, all right. So today, we're going to take a little bit of a U-E. We're going to turn back to our heart of faith community. But before we get there, a little interactive moment. Some of you have received some papers. And what I'd like you to do, if you have one of those papers, I gave it to you at the beginning of service, could you just stand up wherever you are? Very good to stand. All these people are interactively joining in. So it's interesting, 1, 2, 3, but no one over here. I'm so sorry we left you out, but it's okay. If you could stay standing. Now, if you could take your piece of paper and switch it with somebody else, and if you could do it like 2 or 3 times, you know, not 6, because if you do it 6 times, you'll get your own back again. But just switch it around, hand it out. Now do it again at least 2 or 3 times. Yep, just keep switching them out. All right, now we've got that sorted out. Did you find someone? We're still looking for someone to switch with? Good on you, mate. Well done. All right. So let's dive into our journey this morning. And we are taking a journey back to the very foundations of our faith, to the moment where Moses, or some of you think Christian Bale, is descending from Mount Sinai with the Ten Commandments. And it's really easy to view these commandments through a lens of restrictions, to see them as thou shalt not, you know, this sense of a perception that we have. But I want to invite you to maybe consider that there's a perception that maybe is a grand invitation rather than a prohibitation. I want you to see the truth of a breakthrough that we're talking about in regards towards unity, that it requires something. Imagine seeing these divine instructions as God's yes. Would you say that with me? I want you to practice. We're going to say one, two, three.
Yes.
That's a good, solid yes. Very well. So it is the yes, very good. So these commandments are bestowed upon a bunch of individuals who up to then were considered nobodies, they're enslaved, they're marginalized, and through God's intervention, they were told, you can embark, you can intimately be acquainted with the creator of all things. This is a new path. It is distinct from fear and subjugation as you've known. This is an offer to step into a breakthrough. It's an offer to step into a life marked by peace and fulfillment, a life that is simply required by us saying,
yes.
Good. So this concept of affirming God's call with a
yes.
is a powerful framework for discussing unity. It invites us to consider how saying
yes.
to God's guidance and to God's commands can create a deeper sense of unity amongst us, transforming us from a scattered group of individuals into a cohesive, purpose-driven, unified community. So I want to tell you a story this morning. And it's about one of Jesus' great-great-grandfathers, and there's a plot twist at the end. But what I want you to see is the rhythm of breakthrough towards unity requires a
yes.
So let's pray. Father, as we embark on this journey back to the roots of our faith, Lord, we pray that we would understand the story as a divine invitation. God, you spoke to those considered the least, offering them a path towards freedom and knowledge of your name and a life filled with peace. As we reflect on this, inspire us to say yes to your guidance, to embrace the unity it brings and to see the beauty that comes from us following your will. We ask you guide us in the name of Jesus. And everyone would say, amen. So to get us going, we've got a little bit of a strange question. So on the first question, to those of you who have this question, where is the screen? Oh, there it is. Who or what do you hate? So if you've got that, could you just stand up? There's pretty, should be about three of you. You've got that question, who do you hate? And our beloved pastor is going to walk around and you are going to read the answer that somebody else wrote. So I want you to be clear. This, the person who's reading this is not the one who wrote it. So you can't be pointing a finger to them at end of service. All right. Thank you very much. Who do you hate? People who take advantage of others. Anybody else in the room feel somewhat that way? Yeah. Amen. All right. What else we got? I don't think the microphone's on for some reason. We'll get a microphone working and then we'll move on.
Myself sometimes.
Myself. Wow, that's quite personal. And I know that there are others of us here this morning who sometimes feel the same way. Yeah, who's got the third one? Should be one more. Who do you hate? Is there one more? No? All right, we will move on. Now, the best illustration of in regards to hate in this context actually comes from scriptures. You would think, as you think about Jesus' family, you must think, oh, awesome, the family of Jesus. But if you want to read about a dysfunctional family, read the Old Testament. It is incredibly dysfunctional. It's why I don't like the term, you know, I people come to you, I want to have a biblical family. And I'm like, I don't know that you do. I mean, which one are we talking about here?
Because there are some really funky ones in the Old Testament, right? But what we really want to talk about is New Testament. You know, a Christian family. Do not leave it open to a biblical family, because that's way open to interpretation. There is one story that is absolutely remarkable. And the problem with the story, and the reason you may never have heard the story the way I'm going to tell it to you, is because it covers 60 years. It comes about two-thirds or a little more than the entire book of Genesis. And the second half of the story you are familiar with. The first half of the story you're familiar with. The second half of the story is somewhat miraculous, but it doesn't make complete sense until you put all the story together. So, and it illustrates the power of saying, yes. You know, I've got you really well trained to say, yes. Will you give me money after the service? No, sorry. I'll stand there and take the offer. All right. We said, yes, and it illustrates the power of thinking in terms that you may not be used to thinking of when it comes to answering the question, what kind of legacy am I leaving for the next generation? So what I want you to tell you, the part that you need to know, and then I want to go back and tell you the part that maybe you've never connected the dots with. You might not be a churchy. This might be completely new to you, and I'm going to cover it quickly. But I would dare you to steal one of the Bibles from the church. This is the only church that I know where they allow you to steal Bibles, right? You can steal a Bible. I guess if we're giving you permission, it's not really stealing. But please take a Bible. And even if you don't believe in the Bible, even if you might have to buy a Bible, I would dare you to read the book of Genesis. Turn to the part I'm telling you, because this will keep you awake at night. It's rather exciting. This story is the story of a family that begins with the most famous family in the world. It's a family that just probably everybody in the world knows something about. It's the family of Abraham, who had a couple of sons, right? Father Abraham had many sons. Come on, other Abraham. Come on now. I'm one of them, and so are you. So let's just praise the Lord. Right arm, left arm, right leg, turn around, sit down. Okay. Come on, come on, come on. Right, so Father Abraham had many sons. Isaac had two sons, and the sons were Jacob and Esau. You might not be able to see it very well on this family tree, but if you grew up in church, you know about it. And actually, it is Esau and Jacob, not Jacob and Esau, as we often refer to, but they were twins, and Esau comes out first, and he's considered the firstborn. Now, as the oldest, he had some extraordinary opportunities, because the oldest son in that culture meant that if you got, at that point, you got a double share of the inheritance compared to all of your brothers and compared to all of your sisters. And it also meant that you are the judge of the family. You are the one who had the authority. You are the one, when dad died, you're the rule maker. You are the power broker for the entire clan. And Jacob had 12 sons. And his most famous son is Joseph. And this is the story that maybe you grew up hearing. It's a very powerful story, so I'm going to tell it to you rather quickly. But at 17, Joseph swiftly realizes his brothers, all older except Benjamin, harbored a deep resentment towards him. And the animosity stemmed from Joseph being the child of the father's favored wife, highlighting this classical biblical dilemma. Now, there's something, right? Honey, you're my favorite wife. Oh, thank you. You're my second wife, and I don't like you. You're my third wife. You are not my favorite. And your kids are not my favorite, because you're not, right? And that's, is anybody agree? That's kind of weird, right? So biblical marriage. So Joseph is the son of Jacob, and he came from Jacob's favorite wife. And now all these other kids we'll get to in just a minute, but Joseph was the favorite. So one day Jacob says to Joseph, I want you to go check on your brothers, because they're always up to no good, and I want you to go check on them. And generally speaking, Joseph would come back and say to Jacob, Dad, you're not going to believe what they're doing now, right? So the story, in this particular occasion, you've heard the story. The brothers, the 10 brothers are all out there doing their thing. And Joseph goes to where they're supposed to be. They're not there. He finds them somewhere else doing weed on the side paddock. And he comes up on them, and they're like, hey, here comes the dreamer. Here comes the rat. Here comes the knock. Here comes the guy that's going to go back to dad and say, he's doing it again, Dad. You know, whatever it is they would do, they'd always get in trouble. So they decided, we've had enough. And they decided, let's just kill him. And so they're done, right? We've finished this. So Joseph gets there, all smiles, and they take him up. They strip off his robe. They throw him into an empty well. They decide, what are we going to do with him? And they're overwhelmed with mercy. And they decide, let's just not kill him. Let's just sell him, make some money on the side. And that's even better. They'll think he's dead. We make a bit of dough on the side. And sure enough, they sell him off to the slave traders. They break their father's heart. They go back and say, Dad, what can we say? Father Jacob, we found his robe. There's blood on it. It's obviously his blood. Don't run a DNA test, but it's all fine. It looks like it was a terrible fight. I'm sure he did a good job, but your favorite son from your favorite wife is dead. So they sell the brother into slavery, and now he's on his way to Egypt. Now, when you read the Bible stories and we hear these ancient stories, and maybe you were in flannel graph Sunday school like I was, we all tend to romanticize it. Do you know why we romanticize these stories? It's because we can't smell it. We can't see it. And many times we can't even comprehend it. But here's a 17-year-old boy who's shackled behind probably camels and being dragged across the desert. He doesn't know what his life's going to be like. He doesn't even know if he's going to make it. He knows what slave life is like because he has them. And he knows his life. He's known it is now over. And he's not sure what's going to happen. And you know something that we forget, that in ancient times, and I'm doing some more study on this, but it would appear that in ancient times it was practically impossible to commit suicide. It's very difficult to kill yourself. You could injure yourself quite well, but it was very difficult to take your whole life. And you can study that. I'm sort of thinking about it and processing it. But somehow he makes it safely to Egypt. He's sold to a man by the name of Potiphar, who actually was one of the captains of the guard of Pharaoh. So a powerful man, he lucks out. And he went into Potiphar's house. We discover something very interesting about Joseph. Joseph decides to live his life as if God was with him when it seemed like God had abandoned him. And every time we find Joseph doing the right thing, even though right things never seem to happen, at every turn we find him going down this line, he continues to live as if this God is with him, even though fate seems to take him to the strangest places. He begins to gain favor in the eyes of the master, Potiphar, but also attracted the attention of Potiphar's wife. And Potiphar's wife comes to Joseph and says, I would like you to be my toy boy. Come this way. And Joseph goes, no, I can't do that. It would dishonor my master. It would dishonor your husband. And then he says, and it's kind of funny, he says it would dishonor my master, your husband, your married, and it would also dishonor, and get this, it would also dishonor my God. To which we go, time out, man. Which God is that? I mean, the God that allowed your brothers to sell you instead of killing you? The brothers that stole your life from you, the God who watched that whole scene and did nothing to stop it? I mean, are we talking about that God? And Joseph decides to do the right thing. And so we know the story. Potiphar's wife frames him, claims that this Hebrew boy they brought in their family tried to rape her, and they had no choice but to listen to her accusation. And then the slave is thrown into the dungeon. Now, that's not a cool thing to be in a dungeon. It's a bad thing to be a slave in a dungeon. It's a really, really bad thing to be in a slave in the dungeon because you're not waiting for a court date. You're not waiting for a court-appointed attorney to show up in your cell. You're just waiting there forever. And despite the circumstances suggesting that God had forsaken him, Joseph consists in persisting in living as if God was with him. A particular verse in the book of Genesis encapsulates this phrase of Joseph's life, stating this. It says, and the Lord was with him, which, I mind you, is a good thing, right? He showed him kindness, which is also good, and granted him favor, that's good, in the eyes of the prison warden, not so good, right? It's good if God is with you, it's good, but not so good maybe if you have a personal relationship with the prison warden. I mean, you don't want that kind of attention when you're the slave in the dungeon. If God is with you, you really don't care what the prison warden thinks because you don't want to know the prison warden. You don't want to be in prison. And there's this tension. The good news is, Joseph, I'm with you. Yeah, but we're in prison. I don't want to have the favor of the prison warden. That means once in a while he throws me a loaf of bread. Big deal. The evidence is not there. God, you are not with me. This is not evidence that I've been favored by God and that God is being kind. And yet Joseph continues to do what anyone who believes that God was with him, even though it seems like God has abandoned him. I mean, where does that come from? Where do you get that kind of faith? 2 years later, Pharaoh has a dream and nobody can interpret it. And Pharaoh knows that this is an important dream, that it's a dream that needs interpretation. And suddenly a cupbearer who was in jail with Joseph comes to his senses. Oh, yeah. Excuse me, sir. But do you remember a couple of years ago we had that thing? Let's not get into it. But, you know, we had that thing and I ended up in the dungeon, which I totally deserved. And while I was there, I met a boy and he had a dream and he predicted it and he could restore you to service. And here I am, oh, great one. And next thing you know, they're down in the dungeon trying to go through the roster. Is there a Hebrew boy here? Anyone here by the name of Joseph? Is there any Josephs here this morning? Right here. Where's Joseph? There you are. Joseph. Hallelujah. It's good to have you. Good name. Joseph raised his hand just as you did. He has no idea what's going to happen. They bring him out of the jail. They shower him. They shave him. They cut his hair. They pierce his ear. They give him a couple of tattoos. And by the time it's over, it looks like he actually belongs in the culture. And they bring him into the palace. They bring him before the throne. And here's the most powerful man in the world. Pharaoh. And Pharaoh says from his great spacious young man, I've heard that the gods are with you. I'm sure he says it with a British accent. And that you can interpret dreams. So let me ask, who has done anything dumb? Who's got the anything dumb question? Could you just stand up? You are not dumb. I know you're reading somebody else's dumb. So this could be interesting, right? All right, here we go. Here's the first dumb thing.
While walking around and looking at my phone, I stepped off of a curb and fell down, quickly looking around to see if I should be embarrassed or not.
Anybody? Oh, yeah. You've all seen those videos where somebody's walking along and they fall in the pothole because they weren't there. Yeah, okay. What else?
When I was 12 years old, I thought it would be fun to play tug of war with my dog. Using a sock in my mouth, I ended up losing a tooth and my pride.
So, as you're looking around, look at the person who's got the missing teeth, and you'll know that's the person. Is there another one? Was there one more? Just the two? Oh, one in the back there.
Thank you, sir. In college, I pulled up to a stop sign just off campus. There was a motorcycle officer standing beside his motorcycle. I waved good morning to him and continued to roll the stop. He promptly pulled me over and ticketed me and wished me good morning as well.
Oh, that is classic. So Joseph, in our story, does the most dumbest thing that you could think. So Pharaoh is saying, can you interpret the dream? And what does Joseph say? He says, no. This is Pharaoh. But then he makes it even worse because he says, I can't, but my God will be able to give Pharaoh the interpretation of his dream. And everyone in the courtroom would have gone, ah! Because he's talking to the greatest man in the world who views himself as God. And Joseph's words communicated that there is one great God, Pharaoh, by the way, to whom you are accountable to. And you imagine the palace guards reaching for their swords, you know, and Pharaoh's like, whoa, slow down, I need the interpretation before you kill him, you know. And he tells the dream, and Joseph says, got it, here's what your dream means. For the next 7 years, Egypt is going to have such a bountiful harvest that you're not going to know what to do with the grain that you produce. The following 7 years is going to be a famine. And it's going to destroy and perhaps wreck the economy of this great nation and the entire area. So you're going to have 7 years of plenty and you're going to have 7 years of famine. And then Joseph does the most unthinkable thing. He doesn't stop there, right? He begins to give Pharaoh advice. Now, I realize I'm not from here. I realize you just brought me out of prison. I realize you probably can still smell jail on me. But, oh, great Pharaoh, let me give you some advice. You need to find a really, really strong administrator. You need to find someone to put in charge of the pot project. You need to build grain silos in every single major city in the nation. You need to tax the people 20% of their grain. Just take it as a government. Aren't we glad that taxation isn't quite at 20%, but getting close? Put it in the grain silos and save it for 7 years. And all the scribes going, that's a great idea. And Pharaoh says, what do you all think? Yeah, that's a great idea. So Pharaoh says to Joseph, I'm putting you in charge. And again, everybody in the corner were like, you know, wait a minute. We've only known this guy for like, what? What's time now? 15 minutes? I mean, come on, he's not even from here. Can't we find a greater, wiser man in your kingdom? And on that day, Joseph becomes the prime minister of Egypt, the second in command. Joseph diligently manages the grain supplies for the bountiful years and builds silos across the land. And when January 1 hits, the famine begins in the 8th year, it all comes to an end. Nobody can grow anything. The people are starving. And he starts distributing the grain to the starving Egyptians. News of the available food in Egypt spreads and attracts people from far and wide. 2 years into the famine, Joseph's own family, out of food, is compelled to go to Egypt for provisions. You should read your Bible. This is what happens. So Israel's, that's Jacob's sons, right? Remember that Jacob is Joseph's father. And by this time, God has changed his name to Israel. So that's where we get the name Israel from. An interesting little Bible tidbit there. So Israel's sons were among those who wanted to buy grain, for their famine was great in the land of Canaan also. Now Joseph was the governor of the land and the person who sold the grain to all his people. And so when Joseph's brothers arrived, they bowed down to him. Take note of this. Everybody say bowed. It's going to be important. Bowed down to him with their faces to the ground. As soon as Joseph saw his brothers, he recognized them. Now at this point, he's 39 years old. It's been 22 years since he last saw his brothers, and here they are. And not only there they are in a row, bowed down to him. I want you to connect in the moment. Here's this young man, and he remembers their voices as he stood at the bottom of the cistern. He remembers the terror. Think about trauma that we see people being involved in our culture. Think about the trauma that Joseph has as he, as a 17-year-old brother, was under the fate of his brother's hands. He remembers the smiles. He remembers the laughs as they sold him. He remembers the clink of silver that they were paid. He remembers their laughing. He remembers their drunkenness. He remembers the total lack of concern on the day when, for all practical purposes, he was a dead man. He remembers sitting all those years in the dungeon knowing that this was the end. He didn't know the end of the story. He doesn't have an Old Testament. He doesn't know that we would be talking about in thousands of years later. He had no idea. And there they are, bowed down before him. And their fate and their destiny now is in his hands. But he also remembers something from a scene that happened in his childhood. And Joseph connects the dots. And here's the part of the story that I've only ever found one person who actually remembered this, and maybe you'll be one of the few that do. But it's usually the part of the story that nobody puts together and doesn't connect. So we have to rewind a little further back. Many, many years ago, remember there's Abraham, remember there's Isaac, and remember there's Esau. Here's a picture of Esau. And if you grew up watching Lost, you'll get a chuckle out of that. So when Esau and Jacob were teenagers, maybe in middle school, maybe high school, when Jacob and Esau were teenagers, they were twin brothers, but they're very, very different. Esau is a woodsman, and he loved to hunt and loved to fish. Jacob was an extraordinary cook. He had all sorts of different skills. And one day, Genesis tells us that when Esau was a teenager, and Jacob's a teenager, Esau is out hunting for several days, and he has nothing to show for it. He's starving to death. And he comes home, he smells something so good, walks into the kitchen. There's Jacob stirring a pot of stew. Oh, Jacob, I've got to have some stew. Give me some stew because I'm going to die. And we all know that 17-year-olds have not got their amygdala fully formed and they do stupid things. I have an 18-year-old. In this rare moment, the younger brother, because younger brothers never had the opportunity to have leverage against any of the older brothers never need anything from the younger brothers, but in this moment, suddenly the older needs something from the younger. And Jacob, the smart younger brother, does what every younger brother does in this situation. He says, okie dokie, let's start the bidding at the top and we'll work our way down. He says, let's make a trade. I'll trade you a bowl of soup for your birthright. The birthright, as I said earlier, meant that he would inherit over half of everything from his very wealthy father. Actually, two-thirds. If there's just two of them, two-thirds to the older brother, one-third to the younger. Birthright meant that he would possibly have two or three, four times as much wealth as his older brother. And Esau, as a teenager, front lobes only, and very, very hungry, it's all about now. And he says, sold, deal. And he trades his birthright for a bowl of stew. And he ate his stew, and the stew was gone. But what was most valuable, the most valuable thing that he has, an older brother, is now gone. A little time goes by, we don't know, maybe it's weeks, maybe it's days, but the father Isaac is very, very old, and he begins to lose his eyesight, and it's now time for the brothers to go before Isaac, and all the children would march before him. They go before Isaac for a blessing, and the blessing, you need to understand, is legally binding. Whatever the father said is legally binding. And a part of the blessing for the older brother was that Isaac would lay his hands on the older brother, Esau, and he'd bestow upon him the power of the judge of the whole family. Whoever blesses you will be blessed. Whoever curses you will be cursed. And you will lord it over your family. You are now taking my place as the patriarch of the whole clan. And Jacob, with the help of his mother, does something tremendously sneaky. He goes into Esau, into a very dark room. He covers his arm with fur. I mean, you've got to be a bit of a ning-nong to fall for it, but he did. And he sneaks in, lowers his voice, says, I'm Esau. I've come for a blessing. And his father's like, huh? Not quite sound like Esau. No, I am Esau, your eldest. And his father lays his hands on him, gives him a blessing, gives him the authority of the firstborn, and he leaves. And soon after that, Esau comes in for the blessing. And the father is confused. He says, I'm sorry, I've already given the blessing. I can only give it once. I don't know who was here before you. And Esau is angry with his brother. He's stolen everything that was rightfully his, and now there's nothing he can do about it. And in Genesis, it says Esau held a grudge against Jacob because of the blessing his father had given him. He said to himself, the days of mourning, right? Talking about the fact that his father's about to die. The days of mourning for my father are near, then I will kill my brother. And as soon as the father dies, I'm going to kill him. And then all my birthright, everything will be sorted out. It'll be good. Jacob finds out about it and is like, run, Forrest, run. And he takes off and he's away for 20 years. And during that time, Jacob marries Leah and then he marries Rachel. Rachel becomes his favorite wife. We already covered that stuff. And so Leah starts having kids. She has a boy, then a second boy, then a third boy, and a fourth boy. And Rachel, she can't get pregnant and there's all that stuff. So he says, here, take my maidservant. If she has a baby, it'll be my baby. So the next thing you know, every time he comes home, I mean, you really should read your Bible. There's another woman waiting for him. Biblical family. So the time is all over. He's got four women, 11 sons over the course of 20 years. I mean, so anyway, this happens over 20 years. Not only that, he becomes extraordinarily wealthy. He becomes so wealthy that they can't contain his herds or anything in the area anymore. So his uncles and everyone say, you've got to leave. Right? There are too many herds. You've got to go somewhere else. So after 20 years, God speaks. And the Lord said to Jacob, go back to the land of your fathers. That would be Abram, Isaac, and Esau. And to your relatives, and I will be with you. To which, no doubt, Jacob thought, you better be with me. Because if Esau is the same Esau I left 20 years ago, he's not only going to kill me, he's going to kill my sons, he's going to take my wives, he's going to take everything that I have that I'm bringing, and he'll see all the wealth that I'm bringing, and he won't be able to resist it. And he'll say to himself, at last, God has vindicated me and bringing me back all the wealth that was stolen from me. And these are the stories that the wives understood. These are stories that the kids understood. We're going back to see Uncle Esau. Isn't that the Esau that's dangerous? Yes. We're going back to meet Uncle Esau, but isn't Uncle Esau the one that Daddy told us about when he told us that story? Yes, that Uncle Esau. So he packs up his family and all his herds and all of his slaves and both of his wives and the other wives and all his 11 children. And they begin to make the long journey back. And Esau hears that they're coming. And this is how the story continues. Jacob looked up, and there was Esau coming with 400 men. Not 400 people, not 400 and their dogs. I'm talking about, and not 400 with their wives and kids so they can meet the cousins. No, 400 men. We're talking about a small army. And Jacob looks up and knows what's about to happen, and it's way too late to do anything about it. And if I could use some vernacular that I won't use in church, but you could imagine what he might be saying. Oh my. So the children are divided among Leah. That's his first wife, Rachel's younger sister. And Rachel, that's his favorite wife, and two female servants. These two women threw at him, you know, that keep having children. And he put the female servants and the children in the front, Leah, the second wife, and her children. And now, and then you read this years and years later, and you realize that Rachel and Joseph are in the back of the caravan. And Joseph is the only one of seven sons that actually mentioned by name. And it was Joseph and Rachel in the rear. And you find out that the rear really doesn't mean miles. It just means the rear, the little wagon train here. And he says he himself, I mean, look at this. He went ahead and he bows down to the ground seven times as he approaches his brother. So I want you to understand the picture. Here's Esau on the ridge, 400 mountain men to his left and to his right. Here comes this poorly guarded little caravan with so much wealth that it's irresistible for anyone. And here comes Jacob. He steps out in front of his wives and his children and begins to make his way across no man's land to his brother Esau. And he's walking along, and every few steps it's like, oh God, please help me. Can you imagine? And now the other, oh God, I am so in trouble. You know, you can imagine the story, right? And the family, the children, the wives, the slaves, the servants, they all watch it because their destiny is in the hands of the man they don't know and that their master hasn't seen in 20 years. And it gets close to Esau. And the writer of Genesis says this: but Esau ran to meet Jacob, and he embraced him. He throws his arms around his neck, and he kisses him, and he weeps with him. What? Then Esau looked up and saw the women and the children. Who are these? And Jacob says, these are the children God has graciously given to your servant. And the female servants and their children approached, and they bowed down to Uncle Esau. And next Leah and her children came, and they bowed down to Uncle Esau. And last of all, and there it is again, the only name mentioned, Joseph and Rachel, and they come and they bow down. So the question is, who is Jesus calling you to love? Who's got those? Could you just stand up if you've got those? Oh, they're all in one group almost. Wow.
Everyone, but especially those who don't respect my time or effort.
Ooh, wow.
Everyone.
Myself, to give myself forgiveness, to accept loving myself as much as I love others.
Amen.
This is a long one. Mm-hmm. I befriended an immigrant family to do some work in my backyard and home with some general work. This has been over 2 years' time, and I have introduced them to Pastor Guillermo to further assist them with a car and our compassion ministry, providing them with food. They have many hundreds to overcome, but every interaction, many hurdles to overcome, but every interaction I have with Kevin and Veronica provides another opportunity to provide a practical offer of love and hope.
Amen. Thank you. I think we've got one more over here. My sister-in-law, wow. Mother-in-laws, brother-in-laws, all the in-laws. This is a story that Joseph had heard all of his life. And the day that Uncle Esau spared your father's life, and Joseph, he spared your life, and he spared your mother's life. And Joseph, you know the story, your father deserved nothing from Uncle Esau. But on that day, there's a reconciliation that no one expected, that no one deserved. And Joseph, that's why you are alive today. And so 30 years later, there stands Joseph with all of his brothers arrayed before him with their faces on the ground. And he's got the power of life and death in his hands. And he chooses to do for them what he saw his uncle do. He chooses in a moment of crisis. He chooses in a moment of extraordinary emotion, extraordinary conflicting emotions. He chooses to do what he had seen done for him. He chooses to do what the story he grew up hearing was all about, and he extended mercy to his brothers, mercy to someone who didn't deserve it. And the story continues, and you should read it. Eventually, you know, he's like, I might like walk like an Egyptian, may talk like an Egyptian, but I'm a Hebrew, and I'm your baby brother, right? And the relationship is restored. And he restores the relationship, and he provides for the family even after his father dies. But the moral of the story is this. What your children, what your grandchildren, what your nieces and your nephews, what they see you do, and I say this to you as followers of Jesus, because we have a tendency in Christendom to like the ideology of instant coffee. We want everything now. But we want to see a breakthrough, and we're talking about a breakthrough in unity, but we need to remember this, that that breakthrough can be generational. People see what you do, and what you do lays a groundwork for what they will do in times of crisis. They will forget everything we say. They will forget who we are and what we are, but they will never, ever forget what we did when we were doing the right thing and it was difficult. And when staying was difficult, when running away would have been the easiest thing in the world to do, when doing the right thing is difficult, when paying our debts would have been easier just to ignore them, when mishandling our money would have been an easier thing to do. They won't remember what we say, but they will remember who we are, and they will remember what we do. And the bottom line is this, as we move into this tumultuous years that are coming, as we come into this election year. When I was at Redmond Assembly up in Washington, I had people leave our church because I can't go to a church where there are Democrats. And so I can't go to a church where there are Republicans. I said, can you come to a church where there's Jesus? I want you to remember that as we move, as we have these actions, the actions do not merely speak louder than words. Sometimes your actions will echo into the next generation. We have to go beyond thinking about this church in this moment in this time to understand that this church in this moment in this time will have something to do for the generations that come behind it, and that what you do in this generation will affect the next generation that's coming behind you. We cannot think insta-Christianity. We have to think generational Christianity, and if we want unity, we have to lean into what God is talking to us to do, and your actions are so, so important. Actions speak louder than words. You're going to have some actions. You're going to do some things. They're going to echo into the next generation. And not only here at this church, but also in your families. And so here's the challenge in Joseph's life. The opportunity to say no was enormous. But he continues through the story to understand that there is a divine. And let me challenge you with this thought. As you're thinking about leaning into a breakthrough towards unity, I want you to listen to this. Are you living a self-controlled life of saying no? Because you presume that's what makes God happy. Living a no to things of this world will constrain you from a much larger story. No also lacks the power to give life. Esau, Joseph, and his brothers, ultimately, maybe even nervously, they had to say yes to the plan. God sent Jesus, who had the power. He said yes to the plan. And he has a plan for your hate. He has a plan for the dumb things that we've all done. He has a plan for the people that he's calling you to love. And the plan is yes. And we need to focus on the power of the Holy Spirit, who will come and give you the ability to find God's yes in your life. And I want to encourage you today as you leave, and maybe you've taken notes. I like to write notes because it makes things concrete for me. But as you've got some notes maybe, and you're thinking about this, that you would take time to find the yes in your life. Look for it as if it's a treasure. And when you find it, embrace it. And all I want from you this morning is this, that you would embrace the possibilities for a breakthrough in unity. And when the next opportunity comes your way, that you would say yes. Let's pray. Father, I ask for the power of the yes. That as we take a moment, even now, listening to the Holy Spirit, and there have been things that you have been speaking to us about, and that we would carefully treasure and understand and embrace, and that we would say yes. Father, I would ask for this church that it would not only be about 2024, but for the generations that are yet to come behind them, and what your plan is for those generations, and we are laying, in some sense of the word, the bedrock for their work and for their ministry to continue with power. Help us to lean into our relationship with you. And like Blackaby says, he says, find out what the work that God is doing and join him in that. And we want to join you in your work. We want to say yes. And there, I would suspect, are those this morning that you are maybe, well, I'm going to say definitively, being ignorant of what God is saying to you for one reason or another. Sometimes it's because of trauma that has happened to you as a child. Sometimes it's because of circumstances that surround your life and situations that seem out of control, or you don't have control over them. And it just seems overwhelming and too much emotion that's involved in the consequence and the circumstance of your life. But what you're not seeing is that to say yes is the way out. You prefer to say no because it's just one more step, it's too much. But let me tell you something. There's this text in Isaiah that says that those who wait upon the Lord will gain new strength, and they'll rise up on wings like eagles. And let me tell you, I think what God is saying to you this morning, you've probably heard that preached on many, many times, but what we don't often understand is that eagles have the perception and capacity to see a storm coming, and rather than ducking and hiding like most little birdies do, eagles have the capacity to rise up on the pressure. And they rise above the storm. Jesus says, I've come to give you life and life more abundantly. The word there is zoe. Suke is where you like get pummeled in the waves and the surf when you're trying to surf and you screw it up. But zoe is saying, I want to give you the capacity to rise above suke. That's the life Jesus is offering you. And I would suggest to you this morning that if you are in the suke of life, the terminus, tossing and spinning where things are out of order, Jesus is coming to you and saying, this morning, you are a follower of me. I want to give you life. I want to give you zoe, and I want to give you zoe more abundantly. And if you find yourself tumbling in the circumstance of life and want freedom from that, the answer is yes, Jesus. Show me what to do. Don't say no because it's just too much. Say yes, and you'll find the answer to rise up and above and out. So here's my sense of what we should do this morning. It takes a little courage at times to respond, but I know that there are people here who can pray for you. I know there are people here that you can share your life with and you can entrust them. They will not fail you. They will not gossip about you. They will not tell somebody else things about you that you don't want them to know. There is leadership in this church that will cover and protect you. But if you need prayer this morning, as we close our time together, and I would invite you to come for prayer. Too often, again, we want the Insta coffee church. I'm just going to get my coffee, grab my donut, and go home. But sometimes there's great value in waiting in the presence of the Lord. There's great value in aligning yourself with somebody who cares for you, wants to pray for you. Because there's an answer here in this. And there's an answer for you. And I would suggest to you that this is a prophetic word for you today. That if you find yourself in the suke and you can't say yes, come and get prayer, because it says that those who wait, those who, like a vine on a tree, those who rest in Jesus, those who take the time to spend with Jesus, that he will give you the capacity to rise up on wings like eagles. It's the way out. So Father, I pray as we come to an end of this service that if there are those who are wrestling in this, and this is not a part of the sermon, it's not something I prepared, it's just a sense of the Holy Spirit moving. And God, if somebody is in that space this morning, would you give them courage to say, yes, I need prayer. Yes, I'm going to come forward. Yes, I want a release. Yes, 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 yes. May you give them the courage. And I believe there's probably prayer teams and people who will come forward and pray for you. So just come up front. We'll gather around you. We'll pray over you. We'll seek Jesus on your behalf. Amen? Amen. Thank you.
Make me a vessel of your peace. Where there is war, let fighting cease. All that divides us, come reconcile us. Make me a vessel of your peace. Make me a vessel of your love. Where there is hatred, break it up. All creeds and colors bind us together. Make me a vessel of your love.
Come on, sing.
Pour it out. Pour me out. Pour me out. Wherever I am, wherever I go. Pour.
Stand and just raise our hands and let's prepare our hearts, make this our prayer, and come get prayer if you need prayer.
Make me a vessel of your hope, where dreams are dead, come wake them up. A new horizon, feel it rising. Make me a vessel of your hope. Pour me out. Pour me out. Pour me out. Wherever I am, wherever I go. Pour me out. Pour me out. Pour.
Rush.
make me a vessel of your peace. Where there is violent fighting seems, all that divides us, come reconcile us. Make me a vessel of your. Come on, last time, sing. Pour me out. Pour me out. Pour me out. Wherever I am, wherever I go. Pour me out. Pour me out. Pour me out. Wherever I am, wherever I go.
What a powerful message this morning on the importance of our yes. What a beautiful reminder that those many, many, many years ago when Jesus said yes to the cross, when Jesus said yes to this earth, yes to what the Father was calling him to, it was for that moment right then, but it was for this moment right here. For every single person in this room, for every person listening or watching later online, his yes was for you too, because he wants you to live in freedom and hope and breakthrough and unity. Because the ripple effect of your life is going beyond so much more than this moment right here. And so I want to encourage you that if you're feeling that stirring within you, if you felt like that message this morning was unlocking something for you, take some time today to sit in God's presence. Spend a little longer in his word this week. Take those few extra moments to go, God, what are you trying to say to me right now? Because it'll be for you, but it'll be for someone else too. And that's the powerful gift of what God can do through the generations upon generations. And so as we go into this week, believing for a breakthrough in this nation, we're believing for it now, yes. We're believing for it this year in an election year, yes. But we're believing for it for generations to come. For generations to come, so that my kids' kids and your kids' kids and your nieces and your nephews will never have to stand in a room and go, dear God, please heal our land or heal our nation, because healing begins today. Amen. Amen. Extend your hands if you feel comfortable, and let me read a benediction for you this morning. A benediction comes from 2 Corinthians 9, verse 8. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all sufficiency in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. In every good yes prepared for you by a Father who loves you and declares yes over every day of your life. Go in that grace and that peace and that love in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Thank you, Superintendent Robroy. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.